Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and I am joined again today by Professor Ben Nicholson to look at a magnificent example of a second model Collier revolver. Mm. There are three models of Collier.
Yeah.
This is the second pattern, and this is, what would you say, like pretty close to the best condition surviving example, right?
It is number three. And okay. It's unused, unfired, and in perfect order. Perfect order.
So, what is the second model of Collier? How does this differ from the first and the third?
The first models are prototypes, okay. And they struggle to get military contracts. They adopt to all sorts of conditions, and with the second model, Collier wanted to make something that he could sell. And okay. So all of the complex mechanisms are stripped out, and it's super straightforward, it has a quick release barrel, relatively quick, two screws.
Okay.
And so you can clean it by yourself. There are instructions in the box to show you how to take it apart, and it is made for domestic and personal protection usage.
Okay, so this is the initial commercial production.
Exactly, exactly.
And is this fully automatic in that when I cock the hammer, it automatically revolves the cylinder, or is this?
That's the earlier version.
Okay.
It was so complex that Collier threw up his hands and said, okay, we're just gonna have a manually rotated cylinder.
Okay, so they've gone back to that.
Sure.
How many of these were produced?
Well, we found 80, and it looks like there were about 250
okay.
produced.
Of second model or of Collier's total?
Of Collier's total.
Okay.
And this second model came in three versions. The long gun, rifle okay. or smoothbore, the pistol, and this weighs 2 pounds.
Okay.
And pretty good weight.
Yeah.
And then a carbine, pistol carbine.
Mm-hmm. Okay. A detachable shoulder stock long-barreled pistol?
Sure.
Cool. All right, well, why don't we dig in and take a closer look at this and pull it apart and show people how this actually works.
Yeah.
All right, so here on the side plate, we have E.H. Collier and then 89 patent. That's not a patent number, right?
That's the 89th gun that was made in this series. So okay. It's a serial number.
Okay. And then we have basically the same marking up here on top of the barrel, E.H. Collier, 89, and London.
London was very important to put in here because it was a center of gun production. So it needed to be in there.
Fancy, nice guns
Absolutely.
Came from London. They did That's not right. come from Boston. Ooh, or Edinburgh, okay. Now, this is an interesting mechanism that we have right up here on top. And this is sort of an integral element of having a multi-shot revolver, is having some way to prime each shot. And this is, of course, a flintlock, so it predates the percussion cap. Once you had percussion caps, it was easy to just stick five percussion caps on the cylinder and
yep.
away you go. But how did you actually reprime a single priming pan right there five times with one? I guess that's what this is, right?
Right. This is called the magazine frizzen. And this surface is a hardened surface. It's the steel against which the flint strikes.
Okay.
And when the cock comes down, this jumps out of the way, and it has left a little amount of priming powder in the pan. And so this is a little box, and there is a opening at this point that hinges out where you pour the priming powder, and then it drops in upon shutting it.
Okay, and this linkage basically turns sort of a turnstile.
There's a valve.
That drops out a measured
right.
amount of powder.
That's right.
Through that little opening in the bottom into the priming pan right there.
Right.
So you mentioned that for the second model here, for commercial production, Collier sort of abandoned some of the more complex elements of the design, primarily the auto-indexing of the cylinder. So when you go to fire this, you can automatically prime it, but you have to manually rotate the cylinder from position to position. And it has a spring in the cylinder. Mm-hmm. So when it's ready to fire, the cylinder is pressed forward and nested into the barrel to give essentially a gas seal. And to rotate it, you just pull back and rotate until it snaps into place. And I guess you can actually do that either direction, can't
you? Yes, you can. It's a lefty, righty.
You probably want to keep track of which direction you're doing it so that you don't end up going back to a round you've already fired.
One thing that is of note mm-hmm. is that obviously if this is sprung back, when the shot fires, it would spring the cylinder back. So when the cock drops, there's a stop bolt that jams the cylinder into place.
Okay. That makes sense. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, what's the point of your gas seal?
Absolutely.
All right. So we have a flash guard in the front to help ensure that you don't have multiple firings. But that's going to make it rather difficult to actually load this thing, isn't it?
Yes, you have to remove it and then put the gun at half cock.
Okay.
And then rotate by hand and then load each cylinder.
Okay, so we've got the gun at half cock, and we would then pull the cylinder back, and we can. That is a very tight fit, isn't it?
Yes.
There we go. So once you have the flash guard off, then you can actually see the face of the cylinder. And this is how you would be able to then go about loading it. Can take our ramrod out. And you can drop in powder and ball and ram them into place. Then rotate the cylinder around by hand as necessary to load each chamber.
Sure.
So this is ready to fire. And then when you fire, the frizzen is going to get pushed forward. And you can see that linkage operating the tumbler there to reset and drop powder. And I would assume when it comes completely down, that's when it actually releases powder. And then when it comes up, it refills that valve with powder, ready to deposit another priming charge.
And close off the reservoir.
Okay. Now, I'm going to ask the owner here to go ahead and take this apart for us. So there's two screws, one on the top and one on the bottom. Sort of make this a quick disconnect. Well, not disconnect, but... So that bottom one is actually a tapered screw, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so that helps center it a bit to reassemble. And with those two screws out, can very gently. So what exactly are we looking at inside here? What's that square block?
Well, that's the stop bolt.
Okay.
So when the cylinder is moved back to rotate to the next shot. When the cock falls, there has to be a blocking mechanism to ensure that it doesn't jump out of battery.
Okay. So we normally think about a cylinder stop as being preventing rotation.
Yes.
In this case, it's a cylinder stop that prevents it from moving laterally backwards.
Yes.
On recoil.
Yes.
Okay. And there you can see, as I cock the hammer back, that block retreats inward so that you can rotate the cylinder. All right, now we can just, oh, that's easy. Wow, that is a really nice, that's an extraordinary fit of the cylinder on that center axis.
The accuracy is 2/1000ths of an inch.
That's fantastic, that's amazing for the time period when this was made. So that is going to be not the recoil spring, but sort of the cylinder locking spring, I suppose you could call it. You probably have a specific name for this, don't you?
We call it the helical spring, helix spring.
Okay, mm-hmm. And that's what's going to push the cylinder forward to keep it locked. You can see that the front of each chamber is rebated there.
Yes, and that fits into that projection in the barrel, which has a shoulder. And we can take that cylinder guard off and you can see that shoulder a little more easily.
There's that. Yeah, so right there.
Yes.
That.
Yes.
Locks in.
Oop.
Right like that, to act as a gas seal.
Yes. Yes.
So these holes are actually the priming holes.
Flame path.
Right. And this is normally protected inside this hoop when the gun is put together.
This was the most difficult piece of engineering in the whole weapon, because the shroud, the cover, has to fit very, very closely with the cylinder to prevent flame jumping from one path to the next. And there's an accuracy of 0.002 inch.
Fantastic. Yeah, if you've got your flame coming in here, the way that this would chain fire would be to have enough of a space that it can come around and light off a second flash hole.
That's right. If that didn't work with this, then if the technology was not available, this would never have worked.
Okay, so clearly it did.
Cutting edge technology.
Okay, and it did work. This was reliable. They didn't have any problem with chain fires.
Well, maybe that accounts for the other Colliers that we don't have.
But it's not something that you ran into in records or in documentation
not
anymore?
Yet. No.
Okay. So we've got the serial number for our cylinder there.
All the major components of the Collier are numbered.
Okay.
And a little bit like the French, dare I say, weapons. And then there's a number on the axle here. Then there's a number on all of the pieces back in here.
Okay.
This is the field strip, and the owner would be able to do this. They were given a set of turn screws, and all they did was to remove these two screws out here, and then the barrel and cylinder and spring assembly just slides out.
It really is quite simple to do that.
And in essence, this part is the handmade that uses the old English system of gun making. And then the front end of the axle, the cylinder, and the cylinder shroud, they're machine made.
Okay.
And so in this firearm, you have these two traditions that come together for, in essence, the first time in a revolver. And one of the great design problems of revolvers is the cylinder gap.
Right.
And Collier had a unique solution, which was to have the barrel have a tongue that goes into the mouth of the cylinder.
Okay.
So it's a male and female connection. And it made for a completely tight fit, a little bit like the Moissan-Nagant revolver.
The Nagant revolvers, yeah.
Excuse me, the Nagant revolver.
Okay.
So that connection, that male-female connection, is very much like the Nagant revolver.
Okay.
Whereby it is a completely tight fit, which meant, theoretically, that you could even have your hand in front of the cylinder.
Okay.
Not that I would, but...
And some guns that do that don't have a perfect fit, but Colliers were very precisely machined.
Right.
And I would expect something fairly close to a true gas-tight fit.
Collier's machining, and this is 1820, was accurate to 0.002 inch.
That's quite fantastic.
And the cylinder rotates in a hoop, a shroud, and there can't be any gas escape between those two surfaces. And it's a 0.002.
Fantastic.
Another piece.
Okay.
Yeah. The stock is walnut and a beautiful piece of wood.
It is indeed.
Extremely strong. So it's the gnarly knot of the tree.
Ah,
because
okay.
You have the force of the gun this way, that is, and then the stock is in the hand that way. And normally the piece of wood would shear off here.
Right.
So they had to select wood out of the tree that would have a knotty composite directional form.
Okay.
Another little extra that Collier did was to give you a silver escutcheon.
I noticed that.
So you could have FG on there.
Put whatever. Yeah, that's cool. That's there so that whoever ends up buying it can engrave
absolutely
their initials
absolutely.
Or their crest
yes.
or anything like that.
Yes.
Neat.